Hello, my name is Randy Bush. I'm the interim pastor here at Woods Memorial Presbyterian Church. This is the next in our series of little podcasts called Into the Words. As I mentioned last week, if you haven't seen the whole series and are curious about some of the other books, you can always go to our church's website at woodschurch.org and follow down on the homepage. You'll see the link not only to this podcast, but a link to the previous ones. They're also available on YouTube. The point of these little explorations of literature is simply to introduce some familiar books and maybe some not so familiar books. And today will be a book that probably many of you have not heard of before, but it's one of my favorites and one that I actually have assigned to classes that I've taught at seminary to students who are training to become ministers. And it's a book of essays by a man named Thomas Lynch. And it's called The Undertaking. And the subtitle is Life Studies from the Dismal Trade. And the reality is that the play on words is quite intentional. Thomas Lynch is an undertaker. He's a funeral home director. He's also a poet. He was born in 1948, lived most of his life in the Michigan area, and returned home at a certain point to take over the family funeral home business in the town of Milford, Michigan. Now, the reason I have assigned this to students who are studying to become ministers is that pastors need to become comfortable with the language around death. It's not a topic that we routinely seek out, but it's something that touches us all. And so finding the vocabulary to speak faithfully, calmly, non-anxiously around something that does evoke anxiety and concern for people is an important pastoral skill. One of my best friends growing up was a young man named Todd, whose family ran the funeral home in the town in Kansas where I grew up. And so I would often spend the night at Todd's house and we would play in the home, knowing that downstairs there might be preparations being made for a funeral. And that became somewhat natural. It wasn't an unusual reality for me. As a minister too, I often spend times with funeral home directors riding in the hearse between the church and the cemetery. We recognize that in many ways our professions are similar, that we both are engaged with people at what is probably one of the more stressful times in their life. We offer them guidance. We offer them a narrative, a procedure, and rituals to help them make sense of the loss of a loved one. In the book, The Undertaking, Thomas Lynch, as I said, who is also primarily a poet in terms of his writing, but after being encouraged by his father for years, he finally put together some of his thoughts in this book called The Undertaking. It won the American Book Award and was a finalist for the National Book Award. It came out in the early 2000s, paperback version at least. And so I want to read from the very beginning of the book and then from one of the later essays. And so Lynch is not one to mince words. And so he begins his book, The Undertaking, putting it this way. Every year, I bury a couple hundred of my townspeople. Another two or three dozen I take to the crematory to be burned. And I sell caskets, burial vaults, and urns for the ashes. I have a sideline in headstones and monuments, and I do flowers on commission. And apart from the tangibles, I sell the use of my building. 11,000 square feet, furnished and fixtured with an abundance of pastel and chair rail and crown moldings. The whole lash-up is mortgaged and remortgaged well into the next century. My rolling stock includes a hearse, two Fleetwoods, and a minivan with darkened windows. Our price list calls it a service vehicle, and everyone in town calls it the dead wagon. But then he goes on to the real point of his work. And he says, this is actually the central fact of my business, that there is nothing, once you are dead, that can be done to you, or for you, or with you, or about you, that will do you at that point any good or any harm, that any damage or decency we do all accrues to the living, to whom your death happened, if it really happens to anyone. The living have to live with it. You don't. Theirs is the grief or the gladness your death brings. Theirs is the loss or gain of it. Theirs is the pain and the pleasure of memory. Theirs is the invoice for services rendered. Theirs is the check in the mail for its payment. And so, to you, I would remind you that once you are dead, put your feet up. Call it a day. Let the husband or the missus or the kids or a sibling decide whether you're to be buried or burned or blown out of a cannon or left to dry out in a ditch somewhere. It's not your day to watch it, because the dead don't care. There's a groundedness in the language of funeral home directors, of people who routinely deal with the tragedies that come at the end of life. But there's also a persistence to telling the story of life with honesty and telling the story of death with honesty, because only if you do that is the former possible. And so another one of his essays, he talks about cemeteries. The cemetery in town, for the longest time, was separated by a river until one family, as part of their memorial bequest, actually paid to have a bridge built so that people could come from town and walk over or drive over and be there in the cemetery with their loved ones. And so he offers a bit of a snapshot into this cemetery. One day we were walking in the cemetery and we came across a stone that read, "Behold me now as you pass by. As you are now, so once was I. As I am now, you will be. Prepare for death and follow me." It was a good Victorian epitaph. It was memorable and morbid, a jingle in the stonemason's best script, to which my friend, never at a loss for words, replied on the spot, "Ah, to follow you I won't consent until I know which way you went." And then he says this about the cemeteries. He says, "Cemeteries are so important because where death means nothing, then life is meaningless. It's a grave arithmetic. The cairns and stone piles, the life stories drawn on cave walls, the monuments and graveyards, one and all, are the traces left of the species before us, a space that they've staked out in granite and bronze. And whether it's a pyramid or the Taj Mahal, a great vault in Highgate or a name on the wall, we let them stand, we visit them, we trace the shape of their names and dates with our fingers, and we read the little epitaphs out loud, together forever. Gone, but not forgotten. And we try to reassemble their lives from the stingy details, and the exercise teaches us something about how to live. Do we do this out of kindness or out of wisdom, out of honor or self-interest? Mostly we remember because we want to be remembered." For other bits of wisdom in Thomas Lynch's book, The Undertaking. It's a short one, so I encourage you to find a copy, read through it slowly, maybe find some of his poetry. We tell stories about those that have gone before us to remember, but also because we want to be remembered. And our faith encourages us that in that remembrance and in that trust of the full story of our faith, there is a lasting hope. So friends, take care this week. And next time we'll see you again here as we go into the words.